Hello everyone, this is Verde Urbusta with the Schumann Resonance Harmonics channel on Facebook and YouTube. It is the 13th of October, Tuesday. I'm going to just get into the video here that I want to show because it's 9 minutes 4 seconds long and I only have 10 minutes on the video. So this right here is the description of the video. I'm just going to play it.
We know now from observation of Professor Danjon, director of Paris Observatory, that flares on the sun may influence the speed of rotation of the Earth, possibly like Runcorn and other of Manchester claim that the Earth turned over.
It's the event that seems unthinkable, but would explain the bones, the stones, and the stories of antiquity. The Earth's changing rotation, or a crustal displacement, would leave behind stories of the sun and moon disturbed in their daily motion. It's a calm solar system, until it's not. In the case of a micronova, there's a lot that happens between the blast and our swimming through the ice bridges of a nebula. Let's begin with the rotation change. This is a part of the Vogt version of the event, just like the Thomas and Hapgood and Cuvier versions and many others, and would easily account for the terrible wind and eruptions of the sea without even the slightest tilt change, as a rotation change only still keeps the wind and water continuing onward with their momentum. But surely the sun couldn't affect the Earth's rotation, right? The mere concept seems so foreign that surely no NASA scientists or university professors have published on the topic. Surely you couldn't find dozens of papers on that topic going back decades, and surely if something like a solar storm could affect Earth's rotation, imagine what a super flare in the X100 range could do, something possible on 800 to 2000 year timescales. And then, imagine what the micronova could do. Surely, such a connection between the sun and the spin which we take for granted every day is impossible, right?
From observation of Professor Danjon, director of Paris Observatory, that flares on the sun may influence the speed of rotation of the Earth and there were sudden changes.
That name, Danjon, it's an easy one to find in the reference section of the work suggesting this connection with Earth's rotation, but his actual works are difficult to find, especially in English. They do represent, however, the foundation of modern understanding of space weather connections to the length of a day. Since that time, the notion that geomagnetic jerks and solar storms in general do indeed change the rotation of the planet has come to be well accepted. The first example of solar-induced speed changes was the well-studied 1972 event. Numerous methods detected the shift in the length of day, coincident exactly with the great solar storm of August that year. Recall you were to imagine the effect of a superflare or micronova, given that decadal to centennial solar storms can have a noticeable effect. And now imagine a disruption to Earth's field so great that induction actually affects the core, causing the greatest geomagnetic jerk in known history. As foreign and impossible a concept as this may seem, remember that the crust is literally thin like the skin of an apple. It is quasi-locked together in hard rock and riding over top a fluid mantle. But if that simple picture was it, the crust would not be locked to the rotation of the mantle. In fact, the situation relevant to unlocking the crust for a change in rotation or in tilt involves a relatively thin shell on top of partially melted and melting rocks, still well locked, and on top of the key piece of the puzzle, the weak plastic rock that separates that thin shell from the thousands of miles below. It is that layer that has amazing electrical properties and is a slight change in temperature or electromagnetic condition away from acting less like friction creating plastic rock and more like a free fluid. And since it is unlikely to be geohomogeneous across the planet, we'll have activation of the faults and volcanoes, massive collisions and crimping of the crustal portions, with others breaking open to the fire beneath. Mechanisms of action for both a grand solar event and a galactic superwave might include cosmic ray-triggered changes to the mantle from the highest energy-penetrating particles, as well as induced currents that would fill the solar system electric field and the global electric circuit due to the shockwave impact on the heliosphere and magnetosphere. These direct thermal and electromagnetic changes to the crust might be enough to break the lock even if it wasn't already changing electromagnetically as Earth's magnetic reversal has been underway for more than 100 years. Fun fact, the current reversal already can't break the record for fastest reversal, which goes to 80 years, among others under 100, as studied by the USGS, Occidental, and Berkeley. The fields are already weakening faster and faster. The magnetic poles are shifting faster and faster. In 2018, the North Pole specifically began racing so quickly that the World Magnetic Model exceeded the acceptable error nearly 2 years early. With the North moving faster, the South is actually ahead in the race, already left Antarctica. All of the above is made more complex if the tilt of the Earth changes in addition to the rotation speed, which is what we heard about in Worlds in Peril, the accounts of Major White. If you'll recall in that version, unlike Hapgood's, it was the magnetic pole flip itself tugging the crust back into realignment with the spin axis. Now, if there is an unlocking of the crust from the mantle, we have competing forces in terms of a tilt change. First, the Earth is lopsided and wants to tip over. Mountain ranges rise high above the sea and much higher than the sea floor, with ice caps at the poles rising higher on top of them. The massive weight of the polar ice wants to spin at the equator due to the force enacted by Earth's rotation, but cannot unlock the crust by themselves. This was Einstein's only problem with the crust displacement theory, and he never considered an outside force. The countervailing force to that, after unlocking the crust, is Earth's oblateness. Due to the same forces wanting to make the ice caps spin down to the equator, Earth does have a bulge, and that means that a total crust shift as one is highly unlikely, but rather a heterogeneous one instead, where the liquid mantle ripples and reforms easily, and the thin crust bends and breaks and conforms to the fiery bed beneath. Some areas fall into the sea. Others are pushed up into the sky to reform the oblate sphere. Tough to know which is which on the world right now. But we can start with one potential hypothetical scenario, the case where the crust is unlocked due to thermal and electromagnetic processes, and the polar caps can overcome the oblateness in their wanting to pull the Earth over, not just change the rotation speed and send the oceans inland. We have to begin with Greenland there, because Antarctica is well distributed around the geographic South Pole, and the northern ice mass is not. The ice fields of Greenland dwarf all others in the north in terms of mass weight with the mountains beneath. Once the crust is unlocked, Greenland could very well be the deciding factor in the direction of tilt change, if there would be one. What's amazing is that Greenland appears to have done this before, with Greenland passing over a hot mantle column that now feeds the Iceland volcanoes. Well, let's look at how this plays out in what is an approximation of this one hypothetical scenario only. Let's tilt Greenland down to the equator. That makes this the new equator, approximately, in this case. Antarctica would be on the other side, still on the equator. Some land sinks, others rise from the sea, and we don't know which is which. But in both Greenland and Antarctica, the Great Melt begins. A combination of solar energy and the equatorial position could make for a rapid melt, and a world in mist and fog amidst the rising seas. What is most interesting about this scenario, and the reason why this hypothetical was chosen to share first, was because of where it would put the North and South Poles. Down at the bottom we find Eastern South America, or more importantly, the South Atlantic anomaly, and this is quite the coincidence astride the current Bermuda Triangle just to the north. But what about the other pole? Dragging back, we'll have to flip this around to properly see the Philippines, Indonesia, Mariana, the region at the White Star on the right being the other pole. And this is very close to where we've forecasted that other pole to be, the White Star on the left, which is where both poles are currently set to meet in their rotation. Separating the stars, by the way, is the Dragon's Triangle, the Bermuda Triangle of Asia. For a crude approximation of a hypothetical scenario caused by something supposedly impossible, that is quite a lot of coincidences. The South Atlantic anomaly, the Dragon's Triangle and pole meeting place, the evidence of Greenland's path over time defeating the countervailing oblateness of Earth. And you look back the line of accepted science on solar storms and Earth rotation changes and what it would take to unlock the crust, and we're just one micronova away.
Okay, so apparently I have 20 seconds to go. And so in that time, I just want to say thank you all for being here. I appreciate your attention and your motivation and support in these very challenging times. Don't lose focus.